Okay, it's a great pleasure to be here and to have this opportunity to speak at this workshop. Today I want to speak about this work with joint with Long Dao and Li Chuanma about singularities and hyperfunctions. So let's start with introducing some notations, basic definitions and results. R will be a standard graded algebra over a field K here. So the Hilbert function and the Hilbert series of R are defined like this. So the Hilbert function is a function from the natural numbers to themselves and sense and counts the dimension of R in degree I, and the Hilbert series encodes the Hilbert function in a formal power series. If D is the crude dimension of R, Hilbert proved this, that the Hilbert function is actually a rational function, and the denominator is 1 minus t to the d, while the numerator is a some polynomial, h r of t. And this polynomial is called the h polynomial of r. And we are interested in these coefficients. Here h0, of course, is 1. h1, h1 is the dimension of is the dimension of R1 minus D, and then the other numbers are less difficult to, they have a not so clear description. So this vector is the H vector of R. Notice that some of this HI can be negative, while of course these dimensions are all natural numbers, some of these coefficients can be negative. So this is written here, the Hilbert series, of course, the coefficients are natural number, instead they are of t may not be here, a polynomial with coefficients in n. And of course, if the dimension of R is 0, then the H polynomial is equal to the Hilbert series. And so this number counts dimension, count dimension of vector spaces, so they should be non-negative. Okay. Also notice that if we take a regular element of degree 1, L, if you go modulo L, the Hilbert polynomial, the H polynomial doesn't change. It's an easy computation to do this. So if R is Gamma-Cauley, then all the coefficients in the H polynomial are non-negative. However, without the Gamma-Cauley assumption, things change, and here is an example. If you take this polynomial ring, which is in R, in 2 times R plus 1 variables, and you take this ideal here, one can check that R has dimension R plus 1, and depth R, and the H vector is this one. So already the H2 is negative. And such an R is even Buxbaum. One can check that it is Buxbaum. So in particular, it's generalized Gamma-Cauley. So it's Gamma-Cauley on the boundary spectrum. Okay. And so depth. Enough depth, I think enough depth is not enough, to infer some some non-negative, that some coefficients of the H polynomial are non-negative. Okay, of course, the sum of all these coefficients is always positive because it's the multiplicity of R. Okay, now let's take also, if n is the dimension of R1 as a k-vector space, R can be seen as a quotient of a polynomial ring S in n variables over a field K, over the field K, modulo an ideal, a homogeneous ideal I. And this ideal I does not contain linear forms because n is really the dimension of R1. So, okay, in this case, if you denote by C the height of I, one can see that really because I1, there are no linear forms in I, H1 is exactly C, the codimension, the height of I. And also, one has this, that the fact that H2 is non-negative means that the quadrics in I2 are at most this number. And so, okay, since there are no linear forms, this quadrics are all minimal generators, so the minimal generators, which are quadratic, are at most this number if H2 is non-negative. And also, if more generally, if one has that ij is zero, I is zero in degrees less than k, in number k, then the fact that hk is bigger than or equal to zero is equivalent to this, to have in this inequality on the polynomials of degree k in I, which are also minimal generators in this case. And okay, this bound is, especially this, we will not study, we will not see today this, but this is the bound predicted, the bound that gives Bertini for a prime ideal when K is an algebraically closed field. Here, the assumption that K is algebraically closed is crucial because if you extend the ideal, maybe that even if it, before it was prime, it will not be prime again. Okay. So let's go on. So the main motivation for this work was is this theorem by Morai and Terai that says that if R is a Stanley-Resner ring, that means that I, the ideal I is generated by square-free monomials of S, of the polynomial ring S, then if it satisfies the third condition SR, then all these HI are non-negative for any I smaller than or equal to R. And moreover, the multiplicity of R is bigger than or equal to the sum of the H0 plus up to HR minus 1. Furthermore, you can also say that if sum of the HI is 0, when I is smaller than or equal to R, then the ring R has to be Quam-Macaulay. Okay, so third condition SR is this, that means that the depth of R is bigger than or equal to R, but not only this, it also means this that, what did I do? Okay, I mean, when you localize the prime DLP, the depth of the localization is bigger than or equal to R, and if the dimension of the localization is smaller than R, then R localized at P should become Macaulay. This is our condition. Okay. Now notice that if R is generalized quantum Macaulay, then of course in this case R satisfies our condition as R, if and only if the depth of R is at least R, because because whenever you localize at P, where P is not the maximal DDL, the ring is already quantum Macaulay, so it's enough to look at this when P is the maximal homogeneous idea. So in particular, this says by the previous example that SR alone is not enough to infer this, because in the previous example that we saw, if you remember, I go one moment back by one slide. Was even before. Okay, it was this one. This ring, Smoli, was generalized quantum Macaulay of depth R, so in particular it satisfies SR. But already H2 is negative. So one the point is that Murai and Terai had the strong assumption that R is a standardized ring, and this means that somehow you need something more on the ring, and this paper, this talk studies which conditions do you need on the ring, and so okay, let's introduce this notion. We say that the ring R satisfies this condition MTR. MT comes from Murai Terai. MTR, if you have this upper bound on the regularity of the deficiency modules of R. For any I from 0 to the dimension of R minus 1, so dimension of R is not the first X module, which is not zero, doesn't count. Okay, so after this condition, you can also introduce four modules, but for this talk, I just speak of the ring. So, okay, this notion is good for several reasons. For example, MTR, first of all, does not depend on us, in the sense that if you present R by another polynomial ring S, maybe with more variables, the condition doesn't change, because these deficiency modules are the matlist dual of local cohomology modules. So, then MTR, one can check that is preserved by general hyperplane section. And moreover, MTR is preserved by saturating. So these three, especially the last two things, allow to do some inductions. In Bertini. Okay. So we have this lemma. That is already shown by Murai and Terai. We gave a different proof also in the case of modules, but using essentially the induction that is allowed by this net properties that I said above. So if R satisfies MTR, so if there is this upper bound on the regularity of this efficiency modulus, then HI should be non-negative for any I smaller than or equal to R, and the sum of the last from R plus S, HS was the last possibly non-zero, is non-negative, and this is equivalent, of course, that to the fact that the multiplicity of R is at least this number. And also, you have that if the regularity of R is smaller than this number R, or HI is zero for some I smaller than or equal to R, then R should become Macaulay. Okay, so we have this lemma that is true also for modulus. If for modulus, in this case, you have sorry. In this case, you have to assume that the modulus is generated in degree non-negative degrees. Okay. So the main theorem that we could show with Long and Lynch one is this: if R has dimension d and satisfies SR, condition SR, and one of the following holds. Or K has characteristic zero, R is do bois in codimension D minus one. So this means that, for example, if it is the project of R smooth projective scheme is okay. So in this case, or okay, this other case, we can say R to one codimension D minus two, but at this time we need that the dimension of R is exactly R plus one, where the depth of R satisfies set condition SR, where R is one less than dimension. Also, always characteristic zero instead of characteristic P, R is a pure, in the sense that the Frobenius morphism is pure, it's a pure morphism. Then in this case, in all these cases, R should satisfy this condition at MTR. So satisfies those bounds on the regularity. Of the deficiency modulus. So in particular, we have all the consequences on the H factors. So HI should be non-negative for all I smaller than or equal to R, and the multiplicity should be at least the sum. And moreover, you have that R is gamma call if the regularity is small, or some HI is zero for I is smaller than or equal to R. Okay. Okay, so we have this theorem, and I mean, what we really prove is this bounds, upper bounds on the regularity of the efficiency modulus, and in fact, we prove something more. We prove that some quadratic vanishing holds in these cases. Some type of quadratic vanishing theory. Okay. Now, since Stanley-Rasner rings R Dubois, if the characteristic is zero, and they are a pure positive characteristic, we recover the more iterate result. But however, later than Murai and Rai, esatto, Cunha Murai, Cuminia Murai, prove that MTR, this property holds true for any monomial ideal, not just square free monomial ideas, such that the quotient satisfies SR condition. And so it makes sense to ask the following questions. So is it true that R satisfies MTR, and so all the beautiful positivity properties of each vector if R satisfies the SR condition as R, so is enough depth, and for example, K has characteristic zero and the S mod, the radical of I is the one codimensional R minus one, so just look at the radical. Or K has characteristic zero and R is the one in codimensional R minus two, so we add the connection d minus 1. And then we add another result that says that it's true if Dubois in connection r minus 1, but the ring has dimension r plus 1. And I mean, we believe to this because this okay, sorry. I mean, this would be somehow sharp because if R is 2, this is true. Because if R is 2, R satisfies S2. So the proj of R is connected in codimension 1. Satisfies S2, you can go to the algebra closure. It does not depend on the algebra, you can extend the field. So you can assume K is algebraically closed. Satisfies S2, so connected in codimension 1. Dubois in codimension 0 plus miss R0. And you have also S2, so reduced. So if connected in codimension 1 and reduced by Bertini, you have that the true should be non-negative. So it makes sense to expect this. This would be quite sharp. So in particular, for example, this is the first case that we don't know if R is normal, say of dimension 4, for example, and satisfies S3. Is H3 bigger than or equal to zero, so normal R1, so in particular Dubois in codimension 1. And I mean, this we don't know. And then also, if K has positive characteristic and the reduced ring is pure, or K is positive characteristic and R is F-injective. I mean, F-injective is something which is weaker than F-pure, and actually F-injective is the counterpart, is the characteristic P counterpart of Dubois. Because there is a result of Schwede that says that if something is F in the reduction mod P is F injective for infinitely many prime P, then it should be Dubois. the conference is conjectured to be true. So, I mean, I think Jacques is the right answer for Dubois. On the other hand, Cordaro vanishing is not true in characteristic P. So, here we assume that R is a finjective, and the project R is really a finjective, not just project R is a finjective, that would be much weaker. Okay, now I want to finish just discussing a bit this last point, this fourth point. Okay, suppose that K has a positive characteristic. Then we give this definition. We say that R is the deformation equivalent to a ring. So we abbreviate by saying that R is def pure. Def pure. If essentially R, okay, is the title. So there exists domain A, which technicality, we assume to be essentially a finite type over K, and a flat A algebra array, which is finitely generated over A, is an algebra, and such that all fibers are standard graded, and we want that one fiber is R and one is a pure. So in particular, this means that there are two prime ideas P and Q, such that the fiber P is isomorphic to R, and the fiber Q is a pure. So, okay. But first of all, notice this, that if R is F pure, then it is for sure F pure, because in this case it is enough to take as A K, the field as array R, and P equal to Q equal to 0. But there are many rings which are not F pure, but are F pure. And okay, as we will see. So, a proposition always in the same paper is that if R is def pure and satisfies star condition as R, then also in this case you have empty R. And so, all this bounds on the H vector. So, okay, recall that. Just last slide to see some examples of def pure. Recall that R is S mod I, where S is a polynomial ring, and I is a homogeneous idea. So, okay, one example is this. If the initial of I is square free for some monomial order, you take some monomial order, compute the initial of I, and it is a square free monomial idea. Then in this case, one can check that R is F pure, because you can see the process by a deformation, and the generic fiber is R. The special fiber is R as mod the initial of I, and as mod the initial of I is F pure, because the initial is right there by square phi. But in this case, there are many examples in which R is not necessarily a pure. For example, if I is an ideal generated by, is a binomial edge ideal, R is not a pure in general, but the initial idea is square. Here is another example. If you take this idea in three variables, then, in this case, R is F pure, the S mod I. In fact, it's enough to take as A, K of t, KT, as J this idea here. Okay, this ideal and array st mod j, mod this ideal j. Then in this case, if you look at the fiber over t minus 1, this is just array mod mod out by t minus 1, and this is r, s mod I. But if you look at the fiber at t, this is array mod t, which is just this, which is s mod a square phi monomial, and this is f pure. So, okay, in particular, see, notice that the characteristic of k is 5, r is not even f-injective. So, I mean, there are also some non-f-injective rings which may be def pure. So one question that I don't expect that the answer is positive, but I also don't know any obstructions for the moment. So one question is this, is there, can you find an example of a f-injective standard radic algebra which is not def pure? Okay, I finish here. Thank you.
Are there any questions?
Again?
Not
quantum Macaulay, the pure. Yes, I mean all the ideal there in the any ideal I which has an initial ideal which is square phi is the pure. So there are many non quantum Macaulay, not a pure. And also not a, they should be, these are all f-injective. They are also f-injective and the full because a purity deforms to f-injective and f-full. But in this example here, this deformation is not a Grobner deformation. So for this kind of deformation is different.
You have proved some results on the on Kodaira vanishing for symbolic powers if you're sufficiently smooth. Okay, this gives some new results here on the edge coefficient for powers or not?
For symbolic powers, but some powers, results. Okay. If you assume that you have a vanishing, it solves for symbolic powers, but you have this upper bound on the regularity.
Yes, to start with. Yeah.
This, given I minus R, I mean this sharp. Do you have a... Okay.
You had a question where the
regularity
of the
deficiency module is smaller than or equal to I minus R. And so you are asking if you think that there is a way to have this upper bound for symbolic powers?
Yeah, for smooth things, for instance.
For see, yes, if it, if you have a good singularity. Okay, I don't know about how do you think to we can talk later.
Yeah, I think maybe we've got another talk. But okay, maybe we have a break of about 10 minutes. We'll start 5 minutes late. I think it's okay. We'll cut a little bit into the tea break. So 2:45, please.